So you're still bullish on the price of oil. What takes us higher? I mean, we've already seen a more than 20% rally this year.
Well, let's remember we saw a 30% decline at the very end of last year. We still haven't recouped where we were at the midpoint of last year. Now, what are the key bull points? Let's just start with on the demand side. Demand out of China for both December and January was quite strong. Even in Europe, which has all the macro concerns, French demand, it's not weather-related, was up 7%. Even Italy's demand was up 4%. These are January numbers. So net-net, the demand picture looks, I'm not going to say it's gangbusters, but it's rock solid. Turning to the supply side, OPEC is pursuing a shock and awe strategy. They're down 500 more than what we anticipated. You have Venezuela losing supplies, and Russia also committed this morning, and part of the reason we're up to, hey, they're going to have these cuts implemented in full by March. This market's likely to be rebalanced by April. So we could see this market trading up into a 70-75 range on a Brent basis.
I want to ask about that demand point that you mentioned. When it comes to China, is the stimulus they're pursuing this time around the classic type that's very energy intensive, it's infrastructure, it's build a bridge? Likewise, if we do get a China-US trade deal, does that boost energy demand?
I think if we go to what's going on in China, the issue there really is for the metals markets, and they priced in a lot of that as well.
Right.
When you turn to energy, when we look at that big credit surge, the one thing about it, it was mostly short-term loans as opposed to long-term loans. Which is really goes as cash on the balance sheets of the companies as opposed to creating real demand down the road. I think the main message we take from it, it's indicative of the fact that the government will step in and try to backstop any type of economic weakness.
On the supply side, you mentioned the OPEC production curbs, which they're firmly doing, as you noted. But what about President Trump's jawboning? I mean, he occasionally steps in, usually on Twitter, and calls out OPEC because prices are going up too much.
Well, clearly he did that last week, and it had a modest impact. But I look at what they're likely have to do this year. They're going to have to exit these cuts. They're doing something very different. They're cutting very sharply, rebalance the market, and then they can get out. So if you think about it, this market is rebalanced by April. They need to start talking about exit strategy by May or June of this year. So I don't think they're going to be conflicting messages between OPEC and Trump later on this year.
Is that having a much bigger effect on the supply side than Venezuela? I ask because how quickly could the picture in Venezuela change and then have a sort of opposite effect on the price?
But we think the impact in Venezuela is still relatively modest. We put it at about 100,000 barrels a day. We think it can grow to about 200 or 300. That's still much smaller than what we saw as coming out of Saudi. Saudi and Russia, I really like the term shock and awe. And the reason why I say shock and awe is before they did little cuts. And then the prices rose too high. The shale producers respond and created a substantial surplus, 700,000 barrels per day, extra supply in 17. They're not repeating it this time. Get in, drop the production, and get out of there.
But, I mean, that is the bear case, right, that the U.S. producers are very resilient and continue to grow.
Well, they got hit pretty hard with that 30% decline at the end of last year. And we already, the drilling came off during December and January. Again, this is why OPEC has a really short window to accomplish this, which is why I think they'll be done by April.
When you hear that there's the possibility in a U.S.-China trade deal that China will agree to buy a load of LNG exports from Cheniere, is that realistic? And is it something that they'll do just briefly and then go back to buying their LNG from the Qataris and the Australians and so on and so forth?
Well, I think it's very realistic. However, from a pricing perspective, it mostly be topping or winter demand. So when it gets really cold in China, and they'll have to bring in cargoes from very far away in the Gulf Coast. But it's not going to be a baseload demand, at least in the near term. So I definitely could see them realistically taking these cargoes.
What about the relationship here with oil and the dollar? The dollar's sort of been languishing, but not maintaining its current relationship of when the dollar stays strong. We've seen oil strength with it lately.
Right. Well, I think the world we lived in from 2001 to 2015 was an anomaly. For all those years before 2001, there was zero correlation between the dollar and oil, and it's been zero correlation since 2015. Why did you get it in that period, 01 to 2000? It was that emerging market bull story created that creation of the sovereign wealth funds. They came in and bought dollar assets. Dollar went up, demand for oil went up, and you had that correlation between the two over that time period. There's really no justification in the current environment.
What's happened to gold in the last week to 10 days? It had a nice start to the year, just dropped off the last few trading sessions.
Well, I think you had a substantial, you had the FOMC, the trade war, and you put those two facts together with an improvement in actually, the central bank buying was the other big, the third issue that drove it up. What took it back the most recent time period is the fact that, hey, if we get a positive solution to this trade war, you'd like to see a pullback. We actually think this is a pound-the-table time to be buying gold right now. We're sticking to our 1450 target.
Why now?
Because you've sold off on, I think, too overly optimistic view of the trade war. Actually, you saw what happened today. You know, people, you came out this morning with better odds on it, and the market clearly didn't get that excited about it.